Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the iBUG Buzz number 565 for January 2nd of 2023. Happy New Year, everyone, and wish you a very happy, healthy 2023. This is our first iBUG Buzz for the new year. I am Maria, and I will be the facilitator this Monday evening, along with Sandhya. This is an open forum for the discussion. Anyone with questions or issues with their iPhones, iPads, iPod Touches, Apple Watches, or Apple TVs, in particular pertaining to the accessibility features and the voiceover screen readers on these devices. So this is for anyone who is wanting to become more proficient in using the voiceover and other accessibility features. We do talk about use of things like braille displays and keyboards and other accessories as well. So welcome to everyone who is joining in tonight live, and to those who are listening back to the conference via the recorded podcast playback. I'm now going to turn this over to Sandhya, because this is just one of many things that we do throughout the month. And we have so many that she's only going to tell you about what we have going on this week. But then Sandhya is also going to let you know how you can connect with us in various ways so that you can find out about everything that we are doing throughout the month, and just staying continuously connected with us. So Sandhya.
All right. Thank you, Maria. Yes, indeed. We do have, did I just say indeed? Okay.
Yes. Indeed, okay. You did.
Indeed, I did. All right. So we have a lot of stuff to get the 2023 started. So for the next 2 hours, we're going to be doing iBUG Buzz. We're going to talk about all things that Maria just said. Tomorrow, so everything that all times are central, and everything is on Zoom unless specified otherwise. Tomorrow from 5 to 6, we have the iBUG Mac Buzz on Clubhouse, all things relating to the Mac. Wednesday, we are off. Then Thursday is iBUG Trekkie Talk, the Next Generation, Season 5, Episodes 20 and 21. That's from 8 to 9:30. Then Friday is iBUG Night at the Virtual Movies. Stick around for the top of the hour. We're going to have those awesome clues and more awesome prizes. So check that out at the top of the hour, at the midpoint of our call. Saturday is It's iBUG's Life. No, iBUG Unplugged. Yes, iBUG Unplugged. And there, that is at 8 p.m., I believe, 8 p.m., and we're going to be talking about being your best self in 2023. So we're going to be talking about your plans and your goals and all that good stuff. So come for that. And then we wrap up the week with iBUG Cafe from 4 to 6 Central on Sunday. And there we're going to be talking about something that is near and dear to many people, the Apple Watch. We have a lot of questions about that. It is a powerful device, so come and check it out. See if maybe you got one from Santa this year, or maybe you want to ask for one. You know, he might still be around to bring you one. So those are the events just for this week. We will now tell you a little bit about our social media. We have a website, ibugtoday.org, ibugtoday.org. We have a Twitter account, is at ibugtoday. We have a Facebook page, facebook.com/group/iBUGtoday. We also have a Facebook fan page, and we have an email, iBUGtoday@gmail.com. We have a mentoring program. If you need help with your beginner user with your iPhone, complete the application under the training tab for being a mentee. If on the converse, you are experienced user with your iPhone and would like to help someone else, complete the application to be a mentor. All right, Maria, I will hand it back to you. That's what's happening in the iBUG world this week.
All right. Thank you, Sandhya. And just a reminder that all of our services are provided free of charge. With that Apple Watch, by the way, I just found out today, you might also be able to, depending on your insurance, get some reimbursement for an Apple Watch as a wearable fitness device if you're wanting to get one for yourself. So something you might want to check out. All right. With that, before we get started with questions, let's go around the line and introduce ourselves. So if you want to let us know your name and where you are from, and if you are a first-time caller, so you can go ahead and unmute and introduce yourselves. I'm Maria in Albany, New York. Hey, Julie, welcome.
This is Pete in Jacksonville.
Hello.
This is Herbie in Houston.
Welcome.
Paul in Tulsa.
Hello.
Marcia in Buffalo.
Welcome, Marcia.
Dan, Southern California.
Hello, welcome.
Ned, Kyle, Texas.
Hello.
Judy in Connecticut.
Hey, Judy, welcome. Or Judy, I mean. Anyone else want to say hi?
Greg in Texas.
Hello, welcome, Greg and Helene. I heard welcome.
Ryan from Ontario.
Hello, welcome.
Hi, it's Christine from Woodstock, New York.
Welcome.
Thank you.
All right, anyone else?
Oh, Maria?
Right. Yes, Pete?
This is Pete. I may be the only one who's noticing this, but it seems that your microphone is a little bit hot, just a little bit too much gain. I don't know if you can adjust it on the phone.
I definitely should be able to hear. Let me move, let's see here. Oh, I forget. Is this any better? Oh, no, wait, this is volume. What am I doing? Or no, it's not. This is gain. Is it any better?
I can't really tell. Is
anything?
Yeah, it's good for now. We'll keep going.
Yeah, I
it's
think good you're fine.
For now. All right, let me do this. Let me I'm gonna
That's better actually. Now that I hear.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, good. This is better.
Much better. Thank you very much.
Good. Thank you. Oh, good. I want to sound good. So, thank you. All right. Anyone else would like to say hi and introduce themselves?
Jody in New Hampshire.
Happy All right, New welcome, Jody. You too. All right. Anyone else? All right. Well, welcome, everyone. Do we have any first-time callers? I believe we do, if you, but no pressure. All right. Well then, let's start then with our first question of the evening. So who would like to ask a question, make a comment?
Paul.
Like to get us started. Go ahead, Paul.
Yeah, I have a Shure microphone, an MV7. That I could use with my computer and call in, but I'd like to be able to use it with the iPhone. Is that possible?
All right. Anyone know about this? Do you want to clarify, Paul, how does that mic connect to your computer?
Well, okay, so it's got a USB cable that goes into the microphone itself has a USB-C cable, and then it's got the connector on the other end that will just plug into a USB port on the computer.
Okay.
This is Herbie.
Go ahead, Herbie.
Does the microphone itself have a headphone jack?
It does.
Then what you can try is getting the lightning to camera adapter. I think there is a USB-C one and plugging that into your phone, then plugging the mic into that and plugging a pair of headphones into the microphone. So you can maybe hear the, hopefully still hear the phone itself, and that might work.
Well, and I found some cables on Amazon, but it was a little confusing. The one that looked promising when I got into the comment or the question, somebody at some point he said, connect to, you need a USB-C to USB-B cable. And I'm like, you know, not figuring out how that's going to work. But also there was, I read something about maybe Zoom has issues with using the microphone, like it doesn't switch over from the phone to the external microphone.
This is Herbie.
All right. Go ahead, Herbie.
I've had more issues with Clubhouse with that type of thing than Zoom. But, you know, again, all you can do is get the light and the camera adapter and give it a try, and it either works or it doesn't.
Okay, well, I'll give that a shot. That's what it's going to do anyway. But
all right. And just to clarify, so Paul, I'm not sure in terms of the USB-B reference that you were, so because I have one of these adapters, I need to try it actually with my Blue Yeti. I haven't tried it in a long time because I felt like I wasn't hearing voiceover even when I had the headphones plugged in for monitoring, but things might have changed. So this adapter, so it's got a lightning port on a lightning output port on one end, and then on the other end are the inputs. There is for a USB A input, and I feel like there is another input on it, which is, I think I'm holding it and I'm trying to think what it might be. Another light, I think it's another lightning input. Yes, it is. It's another lightning input. I'm like touching it right now to see what it is. So yeah, that's something you can get. There is an official Apple one. So I'm not sure what those references were to the cables that you were seeing.
Well,
yeah,
I mean, this particular company had two different cables.
I see.
One was I don't remember what the other one was, but they had a B to C, which is the one the guy said to use, and it doesn't have a lightning connector on it. So
right, yeah. So this one with the lightning one, you'd be plugging in that USB A output of your mic into that. Go ahead, Herbie.
So that is, I had the same issue with the Yeti. I could not hear voiceover or anything coming through the headphone. So that's why I used the word try. And some people have had a little bit better luck with iPads, and it's probably just because of the nature of iPad, it being a different ecosystem. Sure. So,
yeah. All right. Well, I would say, yeah, no harm, Paul. And that cables, the lightning adapter, was it like $40 or something when I got mine anyway? So I don't know what the price is now, but it might be, you have nothing to lose. I mean, you know, worse comes to worse, it doesn't work, but you give it a shot. So,
okay. I'll report back later.
It sounds good. All right. Very good. And I'll have to try it too and report back with my Blue Yeti to see if anything's changed. All right. Very good. Who would like to ask the next question? Or make the next?
This is Helene.
Helene, go ahead.
I have 16.1.2, I think. I'm not sure if there is anything further to be updated. All my emails have these new things about saying go up, go down, refresh. But a lot of words when I'm trying to just have an email read to me. Is that something that's just because of all like the 16s, or is it just something that's always been there and I'm just never noticed?
Sure. All right. Anyone have any insight on this, when that type of the go up, the navigational and other elements relating to email messages started? All right. I don't know when I do experience them as well. I don't know personally myself when it started. So I couldn't tell you when, but it has been around. You have to I would suggest, if you don't want to flick past that, I would suggest just like touching in the middle of the screen, or to hopefully get yourself, you know, below that and into the body of your message. Mm-hmm. And by the way, you were saying about further, iOS 16.2 is out, so you may wish to update, but you will get the same behavior in terms of that. Yes, sometimes Apple tries some different things, and sometimes, you know, they make things a little less efficient from the screen reader perspective, but what to do? All right. And who would like to ask, or anyone else have anything on this? All right, then. Who would like to ask the next question?
This is Greg.
Oh, at the same time. I think I heard Greg. It was literally the same time. I think I heard Greg first.
You have a lot of action tonight. Yeah. I had a follow-up to a question that was raised a couple of weeks ago. I think it was Janet was asking what the auto speak was on the watch. And I did some research on that. When you tap the crown and the watch tells you what time it is, voiceover tells you what time it is, and you can flick left or right to any of your complications. And then if you flick up, you get an option to enable auto speak. And that would be for that complication. So if I enabled auto speak for battery, for example, then the phone should tell me when I hit the crown, it should tell me the time, and then it would automatically speak the battery level. And I believe, and you can toggle those auto speak on or off for each of your complications that you have on the watch. I think once you do that, then as I understand it, you have to reboot the phone to actually get it to work where VoiceOver reads that combination out. I have not gotten that to work, but that's something that for Sunday, Sri, you or someone else might want to do some research on that. Anyway, that's what I found out.
Great, thank you for that. So yes, if anyone would like to do some more investigating and research on that, feel free to report. All right, very good. Thank you for that. And then who was the other? Was it Judy? I didn't quite catch it.
Jody.
Jody. Okay.
Yeah.
Go ahead,
yeah,
Jody.
Has anybody noticed that Zoom has gotten glitchy? Whenever I tap on the link to get into Zoom, it prompts me, do I want to open it in the app or do we want to open it through this, you know, the
So you're saying that instead of it just launching, you're getting a prompt to open it in the app first?
Well, yeah, it says, do you want to open it in the app or do you want to open it in the browser? And then also I had to log out. I had to sign out and sign back in again because I wasn't able to unmute. So I just wondered if anybody else has noticed that Zoom is acting differently.
This is Pete, and I have not. Actually, mine's gotten a little more simplified. It used to give me an option to, to go to the URL, I think. But now it's eliminated that, and it's goes right into the waiting room like it did this evening.
Okay. All right. This is Jody. I haven't updated to 16, so that might be part of it.
All right. Anyone else with Zoom experience with the
phone? This is Kelsey.
Go ahead, Kelsey.
I haven't noticed that per se. I've noticed what I have seen though is sometimes if I haven't actually opened the Zoom app on occasion, sometimes Zoom will say it'll like automatically sign me out and then it'll give me a message, we can't sign you in. So I have seen that, but as far as the links, no, I mean, usually it just brings me right into the meeting. I mean, every once in a while, it'll ask me if I want to open it in the app, but I would say 95% of the time, it still behaves as it should, except for those occasional times when the app says it can't sign me in. But the weird thing about that is if I just click on sign in and it has my username and password, it signs me in just fine. So I'm not sure what the deal is there, but.
Interesting. All right. But definitely some glitchiness as a general. Okay. Anyone else? All right, then. Well, it sounds like at least there's some glitchiness going on in general. And you might want to try also, Jody, like checking for a Zoom if you're depending on if you have automatic updates. It might, you know, not update immediately. It might take a few days. So you might want to go in and check for a Zoom update, too, and see if that helps or either of you. So.
Okay, thank you.
All right.
This is Herbie.
Okay, go ahead, Herbie.
I want to say, and I can't look because I'm actually on Zoom on my phone at the moment, but I think there is something in settings that addresses how links open in the Zoom settings. But so that's something to look into next time. You just open the Zoom app and look in the settings and see if there's anything that addresses that. And I don't remember if I'm dreaming or not, but that is something to look into.
Thank you.
All right, very good. All right, who would like to ask the next question or make a comment? Any new apps that you've tried over the holiday break? Any Facebook issues? Those seem to crop up pretty frequently.
This is Kelsey.
Go ahead, Kelsey.
Okay. This is kind of a interesting one. I recently started playing around with the MyQuest app through Quest Diagnostics. I was actually trying to make myself a lab appointment for a little far out. And what I've noticed is that you can't do it on the app. It, for some reason, VoiceOver seems to have this weird glitch where if you're trying to say like select the state or your gender, it says like required button text field. But if you double tap on it, it doesn't bring up anything, and you have to, the only way I got it to semi-work was to turn on screen recognition on my phone. And even that didn't seem to fix, you know, to make the app work. So I'm just curious, you know, has anyone played around with that app? And is there a trick to making that work? Because it doesn't seem all that accessible.
All right. Anyone have experience with the MyQuest app? All right. Well, Kelsey, it sounds like
a quick comment.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Go ahead, Jody.
Yeah, I haven't had that experience, but I bet if you give them feedback, they'd be very interested to know about it. Because when you go to Quest Labs, they actually have a, you know, in order to sign in, they have a kiosk. But there's a video playing that says if you're visually impaired, swipe the screen with three fingers to the left and they'll sign you in. So they are concerned about assisting people that are visually impaired. So I would definitely give them feedback on that app because they might not know. They probably don't know about it.
All right. Very well. That is good to know that they seem to be aware for sure.
Yeah.
All right. Anyone else? Thoughts? All right. Well, Kelsey, definitely. It sounds like, yes, hopefully good luck with sending them some feedback. Hopefully they'll be receptive. If they've got accessibility on their kiosks, I, you know, hope that improves the chances that they'll be receptive and fix.
Hopefully.
So, yeah. And hopefully, I wonder if you can, yeah. And man, I wonder.
That was an hour wasted of my evening to,
oh dear,
try and make an appointment, ended up having to call them and do it on the automated phone system because I was just, frustrating. Yeah.
I wonder if you can try using Safari and go on the website in the meantime and do it that way as a workaround.
No, it's worse on the website.
Oh dear.
Yeah, it really was not a fun evening, so I guess I'll just have to contact them and let them know that it's not accessible.
Yeah, absolutely. And the website too, it sounds like. So
Yeah.
Well, good luck with that. Let us know if you hear, hopefully you hear something, you know, positive.
Yeah, so. I'll let you know if I do.
Very good. All right. All right. You would like to ask our next question?
This is Marcia. I just wanted to say that I have this problem with Quest, and I wrote a very nasty letter all the way up to the director, you know, to the CEO. And they called me, you know, I said, oh, they were just so sorry. I said, yeah, but you're not going to do anything about it. And so evidently they did do something. So if you don't get anything with the feedback, go to the top.
All right. Very good. Well, hopefully the more people they hear from, the more of a priority, you know, it will be. So, all right. Who would like to ask the next question?
This is Shree.
And remember, you do have to unmute.
I heard Shree. Shree, we can't hear you.
Oh, Shree. Okay, yes, you were very, very quiet.
Can you hear me okay now?
A little better, yeah.
You're still a bit low, but at least we can hear you. there you go.
My question is, when I turn VoiceOver off and I hand my phone over to my wife, when she's on the virtual keyboard, VoiceOver is still speaking. Do we know how to turn that off?
All right. Any thoughts on that? So VoiceOver is off, but it's still speaking on the keyboard. Has anyone had that kind of an experience?
This is Herbie.
Okay, go ahead, Herbie.
The only thing that comes to my mind is, do you have like speak screen turned on?
All right, Shree.
This is Shree.
Yep, go ahead.
I have speak turned on.
Is that speak screen? Green, the or
I have speech turned on.
Oh, speech. Oh.
Or it might be speak, not speech, but speak turned on.
You have speak turned. Okay. Can you clarify? Is this like a in the settings, right? Under accessibility, you have speak turned on?
Correct. So that way, when I'm on the rotor, if I wanted to repeat what's selected, the speak is what speaks it back. I have that turned on.
Uh-huh.
Does that make sense?
Yes, I think so. I'm trying to think what this, I think I have seen this. Yeah. Spoken content, right? Oh, speak select. There's a speak selection, a speak screen. There is a typing feedback item here in spoken content, which is saying about speaking characters and words and such. And so I wonder, and again, this is completely separate from VoiceOver. So I wonder if somehow something in there got turned on. Anyone else? Yeah, go ahead, Shree.
So you're looking under settings, accessibility, spoken content?
Correct.
Okay, I'll take a look.
Sounds good. Yeah, I'm hoping we're thinking of the same thing. That's the only, the same area. Because there is a separate, there's a speak selection, which it sounds like what you described. And then there's a speak screen. So, and then there's this typing feedback button, and you can select different things to be on, so.
Okay, I'll take a look at that. Thank you.
Yeah, well, good luck with that. Hope you can figure that out. That is very peculiar. All right. Who would like to ask the next question?
This is Jody.
Go ahead, Jody.
So I was looking through Audio Vault for videos, and there's the option to download. Is there a way to watch the movie streaming, or do you have to download it? And then if you do download it, where do you go to find it after you've downloaded it?
All right. So two-part question. Anyone familiar with the Audio Vault? And then just a more general question about where do your downloads go?
To Sandhya.
Go ahead, Sandhya.
So yeah, so generally, I mean, we would, you know, not recommend, I mean, those are up to you if you want to do that, but really the best service that we are recommending is the Sero app, and that is a paid service. And that, I mean, you know, there are other services out there, but, you know, you kind of have to be very careful with what you're doing. So that's kind of would have to be our answer on that one. But
this is Herbie.
App is the paid app that we want to encourage. Okay.
All right. And then, Sandhya, were you going to comment on the download as well, or just that part?
That.
Okay. Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. And then, Herbie, go ahead.
Yeah, so I've not used Audio Vault on the phone, but two things. You can try double tapping and holding on the file and see if it gives you a preview option, and that might play the file without downloading it. Otherwise, downloads, there's going to, you can access it one of two ways. There is a downloads button that will appear, I believe it's still at the top of your Safari, unless they've changed it in more recent updates. And the other way is you can also find, I believe the download shows up in your iCloud folder and files, so.
All right. Okay. Very good. Anyone else downloads location? All right, well then hopefully Jody, you'll be able to find it there and do things from the Files app. You can definitely like share content to other apps and such. So, all right, very good. Who would like to ask the next question?
This is Jody.
Okay, go ahead, Jody.
How do you get to the iCloud files?
Ah, all right. Who would like to tell us how to do that? How do we reach iCloud Drive?
Brad?
I think, was that Brad?
Yes, it is. Sorry, I'm in a public place, so I don't know how well you can hear me.
Can hear you. You do have some background noise, though.
Yeah, sorry. Well, let me answer the question, and then I'll go back on mute. You have a Files app on your iPhone somewhere, and probably in the Extras folder, if nowhere else. Look for it. And in there, you will find anything that you have that's like a cloud drive. You will find iCloud Drive. You will find Dropbox or OneDrive or whatever you have installed on your phone. So if you go into iCloud Drive, you will find a downloads folder. And in the downloads folder, you will find whatever you have downloaded from your Safari browser on your phone. And you should be able to double tap it, and it will play whatever you like download, particularly from Audio Vault. You'll find them in there. And you might be able to share them to your VoiceStream Reader app. And that would be a great way to play them.
All right, thank you, Brad. And yes, you can definitely, I mean, I've shared files and such to VoiceStream. You can share zip files, you can share MP3. As long as it's some kind of file type that VoiceStream Reader can recognize, it will show up when you go to share. And then generally, depending on which type of file it is and how you have your apps ordered, it might show up in the initial screen, or you might have to go to more in the share sheet, but then the VoiceStream should be there if it's available to be played in that. And just to clarify too, in the Files app, so like Jody, if you open it for the first time, you might be on the Recents tab. There is the Recents, the Shared, and the Browse tab. So you would want to select the Browse tab. And if you have a back button, it means you're somewhere in the hierarchy. So once you go back to the root where you have a more button, you'll see it's a browse heading and you'll see different locations. Like there's on my iPhone, there's iCloud Drive, and you can add different ones as well, depending on what services you have, you know, Dropbox, OneDrive, what have you. But iCloud Drive will be one of those locations. And then
this is Herbie.
All right. Go ahead, Herbie.
So Sandhya is mentioning of the paid Sarah app just brought this to mind, that I wanted to remind everybody that in addition to that, you also have the other legal services that all have DVS options now with the TV, Apple TV Plus, Netflix, Disney Plus, Hulu, I believe has DVS. I know Amazon has started incorporating audio description into a lot of their things. So I just thought I'd mentioned that those as options as well. So,
all right, absolutely, thank you. And I know, I believe HBO Max has, and I think Peacock, a great place. You know, iBUG doesn't. We have relationships with like both of the consumer organizations, so we're not trying to say partial, but to one or the other. But in terms of websites, you can go to the Audio Description Project of the American Council of the Blind, acb.org/ADP, like Audio Description Project. And that, I believe, does have instructions on accessing how do you enable audio description on these various services in general. Some of them you can set the option globally, and others you can, when you're playing a movie, going into like a subtitles option and selecting the English audio description. So, but again, that acb.org/ADP should give you a good idea of what is available where as well. They have a list of titles that you can search that gets updated, and they have info on various places you can get the audio description. So very good. All right. Who would like to ask the next question? Well, has anyone played? I've heard of it and I've not really checked it out. Has anyone played with the new, what is it called, Sing or Lyrics or something feature of Apple Music? And if so, is it accessible?
This is Shree.
Okay, go ahead, Shree.
So I have tried it and I cannot get it to work with VoiceOver. My experience when you're talking about the karaoke version of it, right?
Yeah.
So what I'm experiencing is VoiceOver gets stuck in the first line and won't scroll to the second line of the lyric.
Oh, that is sad. All right. Well, no accessible karaoke yet in Apple Music then.
Well, we could probably perfect the first line in karaoke.
Yeah, that's right. We can get started. All right. Well, thanks for that. I guess hopefully that will get fixed. All right. Who would like to ask the next question? Or make the next comment?
Well, this is Sandhya.
Go ahead, Sandhya.
I think Helene was kind of mentioning this about at the top of the email, and I missed what the answer was. It was about go up and go down. What are we going up and down? What is that? Like, do we know what that is, or what is that about? As I pushed it, and I'm not really sure what it did.
All right.
It was the top left, top right corner. It said go up, go down. So I couldn't tell what kind of navigation was going on.
All right. Anyone have any input on those buttons? These are, they appear when you open up an email message before you get to the body. You have these buttons now.
This is Greg.
Go ahead, Greg.
Yeah, I think that just takes you to the previous email and the next email.
All right.
Because up one email and down one email.
Sure. Do you know if they, is it in, like if you were in a thread, would it take you, I guess, to the prior message in the thread or to the prior conversation entirely? I don't know.
I don't know either. I think it would take you to the previous email.
Right, the, right.
Another interesting thing with the 16.2 is they finally got rid of the, they had down at the bottom, one of the tabs at the bottom used to be more actions that you'd click on to reply or forward or, you know, whatever the different action you wanted to take on an email. And then they changed that to reply, where the button just said reply. And with 16.2, they've changed that back to more actions, which makes a whole lot more sense.
All right, very good. Thank you for that. That indeed makes a lot more sense, because for those who don't know this option, and you can also access it via the actions rotor item, where it is still sadly called reply, but this more actions lets you reply and forward and what else is in there? Archiving the message, reminding you to follow up, flagging it, marking it as unread, moving it. I'm looking at this, which is the only reason I know all of what it says. Move it to trash, move it to junk, mute the conversation, notify you of a reply, print it and block the sender. So that's way, way more like Greg just said than reply. So it's good that they've fixed that reverted to that terminology. And I did just find a thread to answer my question and they go up and go down will take you among messages in a thread. But yeah, it's but for moving in threads, you have the messages rotor item and can do it much more efficiently that way. But yes, the navigation go up and go down will literally just take you between all of your messages one by one, it seems. All right, who would like to ask the next question? Well, I think we haven't discussed it on iBUG before, unless I missed something, but was wondering if anyone, what are people's thoughts for if anyone's played with Mastodon, which apps, which iOS clients they prefer. And for those who don't know, Mastodon is a social media platform which has gained some popularity recently. It's more of like a decentralized kind of a network where there are different servers that talk to each other and you sign up with a specific server and then you're able to make
this is
posts.
Herbie.
Go ahead, Herbie.
So I have yet to actually get on the Mastodon platform. So I guess my question is, have you tried it and what iOS apps have you used?
All right. So I am very new to it, by which I mean that I created an account like over this holiday break. So I haven't really I do have a few apps to check out. I have one called MetaText, which I believe on the Apple Viz podcast, there was a pretty detailed tutorial about it. So that one seems popular by way of that existing. And then there's one called Toot with an exclamation point, because there's apparently another one called Toot without the exclamation point, but I haven't tried that one. So I haven't like downloaded that one. I've downloaded the Toot with the exclamation point, T-O-O-T. And then I saw an what I will be interested because I like so there's this app that Jonathan Mosen had talked about for Twitter called Spring that I like a lot, and the developer of Spring apparently I think it's going to be called like Mona or something, but he is like coming up with an app for Mastodon, like it's in development, he's developing it, and I don't know. Apparently, like those of us who use Spring were supposed to get a notification at some point about like testing this app. I haven't seen anything. So perhaps when that comes out, that will be my preferred thing since it's coming from the same developer. But yeah, I guess I would say so my experience has been limited so far, but I guess I would say those two at this point are what I have downloaded.
All right, very good. Right,
yeah. And those have come through just chatter I've heard in the blindness community.
This is Pete.
Go ahead, Pete.
So Maria, what you've downloaded Toot, and there may be this new app coming from the developer of whatever the other one is for Twitter. Are these called client apps for Mastodon? Is that what you're talking about? Other apps?
Yes, so there isn't, that's a good point. So thank you for that. There is an official Mastodon app, and I think I did hear from somewhere that it worked or that it was fairly accessible, but that it was more of like a kind of more limited in its feature set because it was more of a proof of concept kind of thing. I haven't tried it. That is an option too. So when I say these clients, yeah, these are like third party apps that are taking their, because the Mastodon, like the whole Mastodon infrastructure, I forget what the name is of it, but it's an open source. They're able to, yeah. So, what is it?
So Mastodon per se is an app that you have not yet tried, but they all access an underlying infrastructure, a social media infrastructure. Yeah. Okay.
Exactly. Yeah. So I have not tried. I think I have heard that it is accessible, and I guess, yeah, you'd think like maybe that should be the first thing to try the official one. But I just feel like I heard that, at least again, this is such a fast moving target, but yeah. I feel like I heard before that like the feature set was limited compared to some of these, other clients, but that's a free one. I might as well download it and play with it too. So.
Sure. Okay. Yeah.
All right. Very good. Anyone else? All right, then. Well, who would like to? So if some of you decide to play on the new, a newer social media platform, hope you have fun checking out different apps. All right, who would like to, excuse me, who would like to ask the next question?
This is Dan.
Go ahead, Dan.
Maria, I know that you have a Hable One, and I'm wondering if you've ever tried replying to email using the Hable One and how that worked out for you.
Yes, I do have a Hable One. I guess I would ask like a follow-up question. Where are you encountering a difficulty? Like, what are you trying to do that isn't working?
Well, I don't have a Hable One now, but if I got one, that would be the main thing I would want to do with it. So I guess before I get one, I want to make sure that I can actually reply to email using that.
When you're in an email message, there are commands to emulate the rotor gestures. So say you go to actions, and then there's a command to go up or down in the rotor. So you'd go say down like to reply, and there's a command to do the double tap, and then you're essentially just typing. I think you would find overall that it's a pretty good experience, that because like the Hable is doing the translation on board, so like for example, if you were to use the Braille display where iOS is doing the translating, you might have noticed like the longer of a paragraph you type, like the slower it gets and your cursor jumps. And sometimes like it's just hard to edit and it's not a nice experience. And you aren't having to deal with that with the Habl 1 because the Habl 1 itself is doing the translation. So yeah, I mean, you definitely would just type in Braille and there's a command to, you know, do a like a new line, and then, you know, the sending, you would just, there are commands to move you know, forward and back on the screen, or like you'd maybe move to the top of the screen and then move forward a bit to send, and then, you know, double tap. So yeah, it's I have done it. It's definitely doable, and I would recommend, if you want to, on the website, I am Habl, H-A-B-L-E, so it's I-A-M-H-A-B-L-E, .com under support. There should be a manuals section, and there's a nice getting started guide, but there's also a, what do they call, like a functions reference or something. It basically lists out all of the commands, and so that should give you a good idea of just all the, you know, things you can do. Sometimes I have found, but I think this is more of a LibLewis thing, because I found it in or even like newer versions of it or some such, because I found this with the native iOS like translation too, that when I sometimes like do a dot six for capitalization at the beginning of a sentence. I said at the beginning of a sentence. Yeah, I think it happens more at the beginning of a sentence, like after, you know, punctuation, space, and then dot six for whatever. Like sometimes that dot six comes out as a comma. It's very inconsistent as to how, and then it's like, I'll delete it and do it again and it'll work fine. So like, it's super inconsistent. But like I said, I thought it was a Habl thing too, but I've noticed it in even with like using my focus on iOS. So I'm kind of thinking maybe it's like some quirk in the latest version of LibLewis, which is the Braille translate that iOS uses and that the Habl uses and that, you know, JAWS uses, that they're all using. It's an open source Braille translator. So but yeah, but like, I mean, it does, you know, work pretty well to type emails and replies. So yeah, hopefully if you decide to get it. No endorsement from iBUG. I'm just saying from my personal experience, I've had a good experience. Go ahead, Kathy.
But to be clear, isn't there multi-dot for every single thing you want to do? Like, you've got to remember how to do, you know, dot one, two-finger double tap, three-finger double tap, four-finger double tap. I mean, all of those things have a special command that you've got to know.
That's right, yeah. That's right? Correct.
So you're doing them on the keyboard.
Yes. And that's correct. I mean, it's the same kind of concept, you know, if you're using a Braille display to control, you know, your phone or even like an external keyboard, right, which is going to have voiceover commands as well for those types of things. So yeah, it's that same kind of a concept. It has its own commands. I will say I have found them very intuitive because like one, if it's something in, you know, you can go one direction or the other, they're mirror images of each other. Like the command to go flick to the right is you're holding dot seven and then pressing dot eight repeatedly. And to go flick to the left, it's holding dot eight and pressing dot seven repeatedly. So like a mirror image of each other. So, but yes, you do have to, just like with any, you know, other kind of external input device. Yeah, you'd have to learn the commands to emulate different gestures. All right. Anyone else with comments on that? Oh my goodness. Did I just get disconnected? Are you able to?
No, you're still there.
Oh, good. My Zoom window.
Still here.
Oh, good. Thank you. My Zoom window. Like, just
Michael just started screen share. That's why.
We're very weird. It didn't tell me that. And it just like my Zoom window just completely, my screen switched to another window. So thank you. All right. What I was going to say was, I guess I'm going to plug myself for a second. I did Herbie's iToys segment. I couldn't tell you when I did this, but the good thing is that if you go on our website, like Sandhya said, the iBUGtoday.org, if you go under podcasts, you can do a search there Or you can just do, there's a search field, or you can just do a control F, like, you know, or your equivalent on the Mac, or, you know, a search feature under the share option under the share sheet for iOS, and search for the word Hable, H-A-B-L-E, and you should be able to find the call where I discussed that for a little bit. So that might help those of you as well who are interested. All right. Who would like to ask the next question?
This is Joni with a comment.
All right, go ahead, Joni.
Yeah, I just got a neat app today. It's called Step Up. It's a free pedometer app, and I've gotten many pedometer apps before, but what I like about this one is you enter your age, your weight, your height, and it tells you how many calories you should use in a day, and then it tells you how many calories you've used for the amount of distance that you've walked, and you can vary your goal for the day up or down from, you know, from whatever. And it's nice. It's very accessible. So that's why I wanted to mention it.
All right. Excellent. And it's Step Up, like two words or like one word?
I don't know. I just searched for Step Up.
Okay.
I just didn't dictate. So I'm not sure if it's one.
Okay.
I'll check and see. Wait a minute.
Okay. Sounds good.
Okay.
And is it a free app or paid app?
Yes, it's a free app.
All right. Very good. All right. And just to let, again, following what I said about searching, I did the control F in Windows I'm using here, and I typed Hable, and it looks like I did my little segment on that on the Buzz number 540 from June 27th of last year. So that is what you want to check out on the website if you want to check that out under iBugtoday.org and then podcast. So, all right.
This is Herbie.
Go ahead, Herbie.
I don't know if you mentioned this method earlier when we were talking about message threads and emails, but the easiest way I find to look at a thread is rather than opening the message, if you swipe down to expand all and double tap, then you can see all the messages within that thread. And I find that a lot easier and a lot less confusing than actually opening the thread. And you can mark the beginning part as red if you want everything to show that way, or you can just mark individual messages as red, depending on your preference. But that is how I deal with threads in the email. And then you can just swipe down on the initial message to the collapsed thread when you're done with it. And then you can delete the thread if you want, or you can leave it, whatever works best for you. So.
All right. Thank you for that. And so what does that, how does that differ? So when you open the message, right, you're using the rotor, you're going to messages, they're all appearing on the screen, but it sounds like the expand thread puts them in like a list as if they were individual conversations. So you like flick left and right to different messages and open them if you'd like.
Yep. So you flick down to expand all, then you double tap, and then you just flick right through the list of messages within the thread.
Right.
And you can read them and you can open them as individual messages if you want, or just read them depending on your preview settings. And you'll find that a lot easier. I personally find it a lot easier to navigate threads that way rather than actually opening the messages and going to the rotor within the messages and all that jazz. So I personally find it a lot more straightforward.
This is Terry.
Right. Go ahead, Terry.
I do the same. And the other thing that I did was to set up in settings, I set my email settings so that it reads so many lines of the email. And so I don't, when I go to each individual email, I swipe to it and it'll start reading me the first couple of lines of that email in the thread. And if I decide that I wanna read that particular email, then I double tap on it and read the whole thing, or I just swipe to the right and go to the next email in the thread, etc., etc.
All right, very good. Well, thank you both for that. It's great. There are multiple ways of doing lots of things for sure. So yes, I learned something new as well. Very good. Would anyone, we have a couple of minutes till the halftime program. And so does anyone have a quick question to fit in?
This is Greg.
Go ahead, Greg.
So I'm curious when, I like the way that Herbie is describing, I have not been doing it that way, but when you go to expand and flick right to a message and double tap on it, if you want to read the detail, and then you scrub out of it, then does that put you back in where you were in the thread, or does it take you out of that email completely?
Right. This is Herbie.
Yep, go ahead.
So yeah, it just worked all the expand. So it works like how it would work if you were like, so you're asking when you collapse a thread and you re-expand it, would it remember your position? Is that what you're asking?
Greg,
or do you want to get back to?
Yeah, this is Greg. No, if I've expanded and I've flicked right a few times to a particular message in that thread that I want to read, and I've double tapped on that. When I finish reading that and I want to scrub out of it, does that take me back to that list of messages within the thread?
Yes.
Or does it take me out of the email entirely?
The list is, I realize we've got to run because it's 8 o'clock, but the list is there until you collapse the list. So even if you were to close out the app and open it back up, I believe that list remains expanded. So
okay, good.
To answer your question, yes.
All right, very good. Thank you, Herbie. And on that note, it's time to find out what movie we're going to be having on Friday. And with lots of excitement about that, I'm going to turn it over to Sandhya for our second hour.
All right. Thank you, Maria. Yes, yes, yes. We have a very exciting, second half planned. Hopefully as exciting as the first. So before we do that, we'd like to give anybody who didn't get to say hello the first time around, please say who you are and where you're from. Anybody?
Nikki, San Francisco.
Okay, welcome, Nikki.
This is Brad. I'm at a noisy restaurant.
All right, Brad. I hope you got something good. Okay, keep going. Who else?
Bridget from Atlanta.
Okay, welcome.
Kathy from Tulsa.
Kathy, welcome.
Kelsey from Ohio.
Welcome, Kelsey.
Did you hear Nikki from San Francisco?
Yes, I did. Welcome. Hi there. All right, who else?
This is Terry from Arlington Heights. I wish I were in a busy restaurant.
Keep going. Anybody else?
Brooks in Oklahoma.
Hey, Brooks. Welcome to you. Anybody else? Okay. I think we have our Oklahoma contingent definitely tonight, so thank you. All right, so now we are going to find out, we're going to talk about iBUG Night at the Virtual Movies, the first movie of 2023, and that will be this Friday at 8 p.m. Central, 7:30 for the social time. And during that social time, we do name that tune. We have dumb jokes, bad jokes, dumb bad jokes, I mean, whatever you want to call it, and just general fun. So you can always come and hang out. And then after the movie, we'll do a discussion. People will say, oh, I liked the movie, oh, I hated the movie, whatever. We like to hear people's thoughts. And then after that, we do trivia. So we are going to hand it over to our very own iBUG guy to tell us those awesome clues. Oh, no. Here we go. iBUG guy, are you there?
Yes, 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 I be here. Happy New Year, everybody. Good to be back with you again.
You're getting so cool, I tell you.
Cool, cool, cool. Yeah. All right, we have another exciting movie coming up this week. And we are going to get right into it. So, well, maybe, oh no. Yeah, let's go ahead and get in too. All right. Welcome. All right. Before we get into it, just go over the rules again. Just like on this regular program, please say your name, wait to be recognized. No yelling out any titles of movies until you've been recognized. And you may leave your mics unmuted, so it makes it easier to jump in there whenever you can. We'd like everyone to participate. You get one guess per clue, and we'll have five clues all together, maybe. All right, so here we go. Oh, by the way, our clues this week are provided by Andrew Tate. Clue number one. Our film this week takes place in, can anybody guess? Yes, you guessed it. New York.
Again,
we're back in New York. Well, most of the time it may go around some other places, but for the most part, New York. Any guesses out there?
That's the clue.
Yeah. Kathy.
Is it a tree grows in Brooklyn?
A tree grows in Brooklyn. Not this week, Kathy. Save that for another guess, another week. You may just be the lucky one. All right, any other guesses before I move on?
This is Shree.
Jody.
Ree, and then Jody.
Made in Manhattan.
Made in Manhattan. Did we see that one already?
I won't see that one.
Woody Allen movies. We've had some bad comments about our Woody Allen selection.
Okay.
So
this is Ned.
We are not going to do it. All right, Jody first, yeah. And then Ned.
I was going to say Made in Manhattan, so great minds think alike.
All right. Way to go, Jody. All right, Ned, then Brooks.
On the town.
Which town?
That would be New York.
Oh, okay. On the town. Well, not this week, Ned. All right, Brooks, and then we're going to move on to clue. Next clue.
Sorry, it wasn't me. I don't know who it was.
Oh, sorry about that. I thought I heard.
This is Brad.
Oh, Brad.
The name of the Woody Allen movie is Manhattan, not Made in Manhattan.
Oh, anyway, good. It's
that could
still
be my guess.
It's still,
yeah, still
incorrect.
All right.
We're going to move on now. Clue number
two. Two. Hurry up.
All right. It, the film, Chronicles? Oh, that's an interesting word, Chronicles. That's a newspaper. Actually, we have a newspaper here in Houston. I bet there's some other Chronicles around other parts of the nation. Where else? Austin has a Chronicles. I think, does San Francisco have a Chronicle?
Yes, move on.
All right, any other cities have a Chronicle?
No, we don't care, will you move on?
Chronicle. I think it comes from the word, the Greek word chronos.
Time.
Which
we are running out of time, okay?
Time.
Something we are running out of.
Documents, things that happen in time, chronicles. Very good. It's almost like a testament.
if you talk about testament anymore.
Well, if it's a testament, maybe it should be called the testicle.
Oh my God.
All right. Moving on.
Mommy is going to be writing your testament.
Yeah, right. I was going to say that.
Chronicles the history of a family in 1979.
Kathy. How about Kramer versus Kramer?
Kramer versus Kramer. We've been wanting to see that one. And guess what, Kathy?
What?
We're still not going to see it this week. Sorry. All right. Any other guesses? It chronicles the history of a family in 1979. All right. Moving on to the next clue. Number three. We are aware of the essential tragedy of the family.
This is Shree.
Shree.
Superman.
Shree. On clue number three. No, Superman this week. Three, good try.
Paul.
Paul.
How about Amityville Horror?
Amityville Horror. Is that New York?
It's Long Island.
Amityville.
Oh, yeah. I'm thinking of that shark movie. That's a different place. All right. Sorry about that. Paul, moving right along. Good try. Come again.
Brad. Godfather 3.
That is interesting. Set in New York, a family in 1979 history with their chronicles. What was the clue? We are aware of the essential tragedy of the family. Oh, guess what, Brad? Better luck this week. Ding, 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 ding. Yes. We are going to finish the trilogy that we started. Every first week of the new year, we have watched a new episode of The Godfather, if you've been paying attention.
All right. Wow, has it been a year since we watched two? Wow.
Yep. 1 year ago, we watched two, and a year prior to
that. No, I have not been paying attention, but I did tell you that Godfather 3 came out 30 years ago on Christmas Day this past week.
That is correct.
That is very interesting.
Very good. And like the others, there's lots of blood and guts and very nice behavior among the cast. And
do you have to have watched the first two in order to get anything out of this one?
I mean, it helps to know the history that they've gone along, but it still is entertaining, sort of.
Okay.
And this is starring, again, Al Pacino, Diane Keaton, Jerry Garcia? No, he's dead already. Andy Garcia, yes.
Okay. Jerry's cousin.
Yeah, Jerry's cousin.
No Fredo in this one.
No Fredo. Fredo's been shot.
Sonny's dead.
I think Sandhya has a cold.
Sonny's dead too.
All right, Johnny, what do we have for our winner this week?
All right.
Horse's head.
Brad cannot actually put this in his garage with all of his other winnings, because Brad is actually going to have to do some work. I know, right? Brad doing work is a new concept, but it is cooking lessons, Italian cooking lessons specifically. Mm-hmm. You are going to learn how to make gnocchi, G-N-O-C-C-H-I. Gnocchi, and how to make the little dimples that make them taste so good. So Brad, that is something new for iBUG cooking lessons. So I know somebody got lobsters before, but now you're gonna learn how to make gnocchi.
I was afraid you're gonna give me a virtual Cadillac.
Yeah.
I don't have room in my garage. Engines and DeSotos. All kinds of other stuff.
I know. Well, very good. Thank you, Brad, and thank you, Mr. McCulloch. You are saying good night. Good night, Mr. McCulloch.
Into the ride, went to a club with jumping. Introduced myself to Flo. She said, "You're a liar." I said, "I got it going on, baby doll, and I'm on fire."
There you go. All right. So now we are
down the street.
Goodbye. All right. All right, now we're going to go back to we're going to talk about our iBUG Bite segment, which is a brief segment about how to do a tip or a trick or something useful to help you with using VoiceOver. Then we will go back to our regularly scheduled program. Here we go. So we're going to hand it over to
Maria. Hello. All right. Thank you, Sandhya. So this today's iBUG Bite, actually, the credit goes to Sandhya for teaching me something new. And so I had to pass it on to you all. So we're going to be talking about, there is a gesture to copy the last thing that VoiceOver said to the clipboard. And that is the three-finger quadruple tap. So tapping the screen four times with three fingers. Now, the cool thing about that, and I'm going to demonstrate here, I'm on Facebook. I'm in the iBUG Today group, which you all can join. And we're going to go over to a post.
Michael McCulloch, Edmund, December 31st, 2022, public group. The year 2022 was full of...
Okay. Now, I did a two-finger single tap to interrupt that. And so you would think that now if I did the three-finger quadruple tap, it would just say the stuff until I interrupted, right? The year 2022 was full of. But and what happens if I, when I do this gesture, VoiceOver is going to start, it's going to read back what's going to be copied, and then it'll say copied to clipboard. So if I do that, a four-finger quadruple tap, excuse me, a three-finger quadruple tap.
Michael McCulloch, Edmund, December 31st, 2022, public group. The year 2022 was full of introspection, information, and determination. The iBUG Today family remains...
Okay, and I interrupted speech again. I stopped it with the two-finger single tap. But what you can see there, what's cool, is that it didn't just limit itself to what VoiceOver actually spoke. It copied... In fact, the last string that was sent to VoiceOver, and in this case, that was the full post, and then just anything that VoiceOver said. So I think it said the, you know, double tap to interact with this post and all of that that it says. But basically, it copied the entire string. And so now that is on the clipboard, and I could... if I wanted to share that somewhere, I could, you know, go into notes or a message and what have you. And I could, and just to show, spotlight. I'm going to go into notes.
Top search result, notes, dictate, button, go, dictate, okay. Go.
I'll open notes. I'll create a new note.
Toolbar, new note, button. Note.
That's in
text field, is editing, character mode. Insertion point at start.
And we'll now rotate to edit.
Misspelled words, edit.
And click down to paste.
Paste.
Double tap.
Michael McCulloch Admin, December 31st, 2022. Public group, the year 2022 was full of interest.
And as you can see, it just pasted in that entire string of text, including all the Facebook admin and the date and public group and all of that. So, you know, we'll move to the end here.
View selected.
Oh,
double done button. Note text field is editing. Insertion point at start. Insertion point at end.
And we'll just verify.
Braille screen, hand words. Menu post open to tap double finger to or to think double tap to open post menu right parent.
And there you go. You can tell that's the instructions from VoiceOver on interacting with this post. So indeed it did copy the entire string. So I thought that was a cool little feature that even if you interrupted speech, it would still copy the entire string. So that is the three finger quadruple tap. And of course, if doing a three finger quadruple tap is a bit daunting for you and you find yourself using this feature often, you can go into your voiceover settings and customize the gesture. But that's the three finger quadruple tap to copy the last thing that was sent to voiceover to your clipboard. So with that, if anyone has any questions.
All right. Thank you, Maria. Let's see. All right. Who has a question for Maria?
This is Dan.
Go ahead, Dan.
Go ahead, Dan.
Yeah. Could I do that? Let's say that I find a link, you know, it says link, blah, blah, blah. Can I do a three finger quadruple tap on that link phrase and have it copied?
Yeah. It won't copy like the address of the link, but it'll copy whatever. So like if VoiceOver said link, you know, the following are the name of the link, right? So it would literally just copy that text. It would say link space, you know, resources or whatever the name of the link is. So it wouldn't actually make it a hyperlink. Like it wouldn't copy the I don't believe anyway, it might. I haven't tried. I don't think it would copy the underlying like hyperlink. I think it is just strictly a text copy, but yes, it would copy the name of the link, and it likely would copy if it did say link as well, it would copy that text as well, so you'd have to likely, you know, delete that in that case, but yes, it would copy the actual, like, strictly the name of the link.
Oh, okay. All right, thank you.
Yep.
Hi, Vanessa.
Go ahead, Vanessa.
Hi. When you copied and you went into notes and you paste, is it a one finger double tap that you did to paste that information into notes?
Yeah. So, well, once I got to paste, so like I had, when I opened the note, I rotored to edit and then flicked down to paste. And then I did the one finger double tap to actually execute the, you know, perform the paste action.
Okay. Oh, okay. Thank you. And happy new year.
You too. And I just, as I was answering that, yeah, I did test it and it did literally, it didn't paste like an underlying link. It literally just pasted that text of the link name. So, all right. Any other questions? All right, then. Well, it's sounding like no other questions, then I'll turn it back over to Sandhya for more of our regularly scheduled program.
Yeah, that's the way we like it. Short and sweet. Thank you very much. Okay. All right. Now, who has a question? Somebody who didn't get a chance? We'd love to hear from you. Anybody new?
This is Tim from Chicago.
Hey, Tim.
Happy New Year, everybody.
Hey, Tim, you got a question for us?
Oh, well, I was just
saying hi, but I do. Okay. I guess I do have a question.
Good. Yes. Go ahead.
I'm considering upgrading my phone sometime this year. So I have I have an iPhone 7. So.
Oh, how exciting! Okay.
So, does anybody have any recommendations? I have a friend at work that recommends the SE, third generation. So.
Okay.
Anybody else have recommendations about upgrading my phone?
All right.
Well, this is Maria.
Go, Maria.
I would say, in terms of, I would recommend not going for an SE and getting some other model. I will say, even like my work, which, you know, they tending to be like more, you know, cost conscious. And I did have an SE 2020 in the past. We just got upgrades to iPhone 12s. So they moved away from the SE entirely. So I have to think that, again, because of the cost perspective, I have to wonder if there was some kind of a reason for that. So I would personally, I upgraded from a 7 to when I had gotten my 12 Pro, that was an upgrade from a 7. So I definitely understand the change. It will, oh my gosh, from a 7 to like even 12, 13, 14, it'll feel like night and day. Oh my goodness. I think, you know, if you're worried about the no home button, it definitely is. I think you will get, you know, used to it. They're just different gestures, and you know, the Face ID is a lot more, I found, reliable than the Touch ID and such. So I would, just from that, you know, anecdotal perspective of my work, I would recommend not getting an SE.
This is Pete.
Jody. Go ahead, Pete, and then Jody.
Yeah, just wondering, Tim, I would say it would depend on your budget. You know, how much do you want to spend? And you know what you really want to do, because you could get up into the 12, 13 and 14 numbers and get into either like I have an iPhone 13 and my decision was to go for either a 13 versus a 13 Pro. The Pro adds a lot of features that you may not ever want or ever use. So I would do some shopping, and it really would depend on what your budget is, how much you want to spend. And my inclination would be to advise you, like Maria did, to, and I don't really know why, but to stay away from the original iPhone, the 2020. Is there a more recent one than the 2020? I think there is, the 2022. Yeah. I've heard better things about that one, but you would really need to do some shopping. I don't think anybody without you and your usage and your money and your budget would be able to advise you.
All right. Thank you, Pete. Go, Jody.
Yeah, the personal preference, I love the SEs, and I think the SE3 runs the 13 processor. And so, you know, for $400, you can't beat it. So I do like the SE3.
This is Helene.
Hang on. Thank you, Jody. Now, Kelsey, and then Paul, and then Helene. Go. Kelsey?
Yeah, I got my SE 2022 back in July, and Jody is correct. It does run the iPhone 13 processor, so it's the A15 Bionic chip. And, you know, I skipped over the SE 2020, but I'm honestly happy with the SE 2022. I mean, it's, you know, it's still runs the iPhone 13 processor, but it's a lot cheaper. When I was looking, I really was going to get the 13 mini, but for the price, I just couldn't justify it. So I opted to get the SE 2022, and I prefer, personally for me, I prefer the home button and Touch ID, but that's personal preference. But I would say that if you have an iPhone 7, I mean, and you're looking for something similar to that, I would say the SE is probably going to be your best bet. And the battery life on that is actually quite good. I can get anywhere from like 12 to 14 hours out of it, depending on what I'm doing. I mean, if I'm not streaming or listening to music, it's usually closer to 14 hours. But if I'm doing a lot of music listening, sometimes it's a little bit under that. But the battery life is actually quite good. So,
right, very good, Kelsey. Okay, hang on, that's good. Let's move on and give the others a chance. Okay, Paul, let's go.
Yeah, I was just, I have a SE 2020, and I'm perfectly happy with it. So it's just putting in a vote for that, or not the 2020 necessarily, but the SE.
All right, and Helene.
Yeah, well, I got rid of the 2020, but I got the SC3 2022, and I love it. And the not only the home button, but the battery and what Kelsey said, I think it's fabulous, and you can't beat the price.
All right. So just to summarize here, Tim, like Pete said, it's a matter of budget. It's a matter of comfort. I wouldn't, I know it's a personal preference about the whole home button, but it's not any different than any other gesture that you have to learn. It's just a muscle memory thing. So I wouldn't let that hold anybody back if they're considering upgrading, because eventually, you know, the home buttons will go away. So the sooner we accept that, the better. But, again, while you have the option, that's great. Just think about the operating system, the speed, how if you like a smaller phone or a big phone, or if you have some vision and you want to be able to do things, if maybe you use your vision a little bit to see pictures. I mean, there's a lot of factors that go into the phone and how much memory you want and just stuff. So there are a lot of factors, but we hope that this helped you out and it's really exciting. And thanks for everybody for sharing their input on this very important topic. So,
and I want to thank everybody for their input.
All right, thank you, Tim. Good question, good job. All right, Tim. Okay, all right, who else do we have? Somebody new? New question? That was good, Tim. We drafted Tim. He was just saying Happy New Year. Okay. Who else? Well, okay, I'm going to go ahead and tell you about my sad story with the SIRI lady. Has anybody, I know we have complained about her interminably on this call, and I mean, I really don't use it very much. I try to avoid that as much as possible, but for a very simple thing, like call my sister or, whatever, or, I call the John Doe, and then it'll say, what do you want to know about John Doe? And then I'm like, call him. And then it's like, oh, you want to call home? I mean, it's just like it's just so frustrating. But anyway, just had to vent. Is anybody having that same problem?
Sharon.
Go, Sharon.
Yes. And also she's kind of like, what I don't understand is because it's a computer, right? So if you say, I don't know, call Sandhya, let's say, I don't say call Sandhya, but she wants me to call you. And uh-huh. I say, no. And then I'll say, find so-and-so. And she'll go back to the same answer she gave me before. Uh-huh. It's like somehow she gets in a loop. Do you know what I mean?
This is Herbie. Yes,
it's a vicious circle. Go ahead, Herbie.
Yeah, I've had the same problem too, and it's very annoying. And in fact, like Shree was one of the first people who did that to me with. Sorry, Shree, but I find it's responds a little bit better if I'm using like the ear pods rather than just using the phone itself. But yes, I have experienced this, and it is rather annoying.
All right. Yes, thank you. And I think another little workaround, it does seem to work better. I have a lot of people with the last name RAO, just imagine, in my contacts. So I've started using the relationships, call my sister, call my brother, and that seems to help. So anyway, that's just a little.
This is Ned.
Go, Ned.
Yes, I recently sometimes SIRI, when I say call so-and-so, she's asking for my location. I need your location. That has happened several times, and then I just turn her off and start over again. I don't know why she needs to know my location. Has anybody experienced that?
Yeah, no, I haven't. Anybody had that weird experience?
No.
Very strange. Okay, well.
This is Shree.
Boshri.
One thing I would really suggest everyone is to contact Apple when this happens. I think we really need to have volume of reporting this problem. I'm sure they're going to tell you, yeah, we've got it. But, you know, the more we report it, I think the more awareness they're going to put the effort to fix it.
Absolutely.
Sharon?
Go, Sharon.
Should we call accessibility for this, or do we have to call the regular number? What do you think?
This is Sri.
Go, Sri.
I would just call accessibility, even though this is not an accessible issue. It's already reported. I think we just need to show volume of calls reporting the problem.
This is Herbie.
Herbie?
I would say, because this is not an accessibility issue, I would actually call, I think, don't they have a department for Siri? Because I think this is a regular issue. I don't think, unless it can be proven that it's related to, if it, unless it's voiceover specific, I don't think this is an accessibility issue. You could, I realize that some people might argue that, yeah, I need Siri for accessibility, and you can include that maybe as part of the comments, but I would not classify this myself as an accessibility issue. This is a Siri functionality issue that anybody would experience.
Right. And another workaround. Okay, go, Sri.
I was just saying, from a reporting perspective, the database that they report the problem, it's all going to be the same. Even though it's not an accessibility call, when they input the information for the problem, it's all in the same database.
Okay.
That's something that volume is important.
All right, Brian.
Yeah, we have to realize also that they are working on having Siri work from your phone. That's not a completed project yet. Mm-hmm. Okay. So it's, you know, there's going to be glitches. And I mean, I get them all. They want eventually Siri to work from your phone. How they're going to do that, I don't know. I can't see everything working from Siri on your phone as opposed to over the internet. But that's a project they're working on right now.
Hope and pray it gets completed. So the other workaround for that, I would strongly, you know, I know some people really do, especially some of the beginner users, rely on Siri, you know, because they're still learning voiceover or not comfortable with voiceover or whatever. But that really counsels in favor of really learning your voiceover gestures, maybe setting up certain people that are your people that you call on a regular basis. You put them in your favorites, and then you can quickly call them without dealing with all this nonsense. Okay.
Yep.
So that is my suggestion for working around that.
This is Pete.
Go, Pete.
Just remember also that Siri works from the microphone on your phone. So be sure you are close to the microphone and that you speak loudly enough for them to be sure to hear it, and that you enunciate clearly. Otherwise, it's, you know, it's probably your fault, not Siri's fault. Because if she doesn't hear you, it may be because you're not speaking loudly or clearly enough. Just a thought.
Yes, I have been speaking very loudly.
Yeah,
very
I'm not
clearly.
Defending Siri, believe me.
This is true.
I'm getting really loud, okay? Yeah. Right, okay. One more comment.
Louder with each successive time, right?
Yes. Okay, who's one more comment?
Three. I will say, you know, my experience with Siri has gotten worse. So, you know, this
I
is
think
not,
you're right.
It's not like a speaking quality. I think it's, I do agree that they're trying to implement it more to the local side of the device, but this is something that it's gotten worse with the upgrade.
Okay. All right. Well, let's just keep moving on, but at least it's good to know that everybody's in the same suffering boat. Okay. Now, enough venting. Who's next? Somebody new question? Something positive? Anybody?
I had a question. This is Pete.
Okay. Go, Pete, and then Jody.
I'm reckoning back to the question, and I don't remember the gentleman's name, about using Maria's tip to do the three-finger quadruple tap to copy the link. How do you then copy a link to actually copy the hyperlink so you can then paste it into another text document?
Okay, go, Jody.
Yeah, I find that I can copy the links or phone numbers or anything else, that it works for any content.
Right. I think the one caveat for that is when you want to use it as a link, you need to probably get rid of the word link at the beginning.
Yes.
That might help. But, and then it might put a space, you know, around it. So, you know, once you clear that out, it should work just fine.
Cool. This is Shri.
Right. Shri and Maria.
So the question about that is, so let's say, for example, if it says, click on this link, but that link is hidden, like it's HTTPS is not shown. How is it copying the link then? I think that was the question.
Yeah.
Right. This is Maria.
Hang on, Maria, then Paul, go.
Yeah, that's what I was saying, that it's not, because it's just a purely text. It's copying the text. And like, at least when I tried it in a note right now, it didn't see, or during the question, it didn't seem to do, like, I copied the training link. Like on the iBUG website, the link called training, I moved, I navigated to that and then copied and then paste, did the four finger quadruple tap and pasted it into notes. And it was just that word, training. So I would suggest, in terms of what I do to actually copy a link, is to invoke the context menu. So like the three finger tap, right? Like the triple tap, the three finger single tap, or the double tap and hold. And then there is a copy option there in that context menu.
What was the three finger? This is Pete. What was the three finger tap that you mentioned?
Yeah, for, you know, like the equivalent of the double tap and hold, but it's the triple tap. So a single tap with three fingers. I mean, what am I saying? With one finger, tap a triple tap. There we go.
Oh, okay.
I misspoke. I'm sorry.
Okay.
a triple
or
tap.
Or the double tap and hold.
Right. Okay. A double tap and hold or triple tap, which triple tap means tap three times with one finger.
Gotcha.
And then in that menu, there should be a copy item. And that's how I've always copied an underlying link.
So that would be the safest way to do it rather than the three finger quad tap. Sorry, Sandhya.
I would say, this is Maria, I would say so, because then you're guaranteed, like if you select that copy link, it's going to actually copy that, the URL.
URL. Good. Okay. Right. Thank you. I'm done.
Okay. Then we have Paul. Paul, you still have a comment?
Yeah. Well, that's probably a better method than what I was thinking. I was thinking you could just click on the link and then copy it from your browser, your address bar. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that'd work or not, but.
This is Herbie.
Okay, Herbie.
So where I have used the quadruple tap to copy links, and first of all, Maria, thank you. You make me feel so much better, because I always, when I talk about triple taps and three fingers, I always get tongue-tied. Anyway, where I will do it is like sometimes text messages, for instance, you have those links that you can just not do anything with, but this is where it is a chore. And you have, because what you have to do is it copies the entire message and then you have to paste it into something like a note and clear all the text around the link, you know, the before and the after. By the way, this is easiest with Braille screen input, because you can at least delete word by word. So if you use Braille screen input for nothing else, just thought I'd mention that. But that's the only time I would use a quadruple, the voiceover copy to copy a link if I really need it. And it's... But it is a bit of a pain, unfortunately. There's no way to isolate the link, really. I've tried like going down to the HTTP, but VoiceOver breaks off those links into chunks, and so you can't just point your rotor to the HTTP colon. It'll read it as HTTP:// and stop. So, which is unfortunate. So,
thank you, Herbie. All right, moving on.
Okay.
Final comment. Go, Maria.
Thank you. Sorry about that. I'm wondering if you wrote, like in that scenario with the text message where you just want the text, can you rotor, if you rotor over to links and then flick down, will it read the entire link and then you can do the three finger quadruple Herbie. Tap and then it might copy everything and then, yeah.
In my experience, it doesn't even read as a link, because, which is why I was, otherwise I would try the link and even see if I could just double tap on it in the first place. But I can't even usually get it in that context, even recognize as a link. And at least that's been my experience in text messages. iMessages, it's not a problem, but text messages is where.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah. Okay.
Very good. Thank you very much. Moving on. Next comment. New question. New problem. What was a new question?
This is Greg.
Go, Greg.
Yeah, I had an interesting experience recently with the Maps app. My wife and I have made several trips in the last couple of weeks, and I like to navigate. I like to pull up the Maps app and tell her where to turn. And so when we get to our destination, typically I'll open the app switcher and flick left and right until I get to the Maps app, and then I'll do a single finger flick up to where it'll say close and double tap, or I'll do the three finger flick up for the bottom and close the app. But my experience recently has been that Maps won't close. And so I'm at the destination and we get out and go in a store or whatever, and Maps is still talking to me. And the only way that I could get it to close was if I rebooted the phone, just shut the phone down. So I called Apple and they talked me through it. But basically what you have to do if you can't close an app through the three-finger flick up or the one-finger flick up and double tap, you just need to touch the screen, touch the middle of the screen, and that changes the focus, and then you can do the three-finger flick up or the one-finger flick up and double tap. But really was an annoying problem.
This is Sandhya. So Greg, were you able to, I mean, it's been a while since I've used the Maps app, but couldn't you also have the end route? I'm assuming you couldn't find that, and that's why you couldn't close it, or there is like an end route option, end route button, I thought.
You know, I probably could have done that. I just typically I just do the app switcher and okay. Close the app.
All right. Yeah.
That's a good idea.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Good to share.
This is Sri.
Go, Sri.
So, Greg, when it was reading that, was your focus when you were closing the app switcher, was the map apps was the main focus when you were in the app switcher?
Yeah, I would hear Maps. You know, I'd be flicking through and I'd hear Maps and I'd do the three finger flick up from the bottom and it wouldn't do anything.
Correct. Because Map is running in the background, no matter what app is in the forefront. So my question is, when you went to the app switcher, was the focus, was it on Maps?
I don't remember, Sri.
Because it won't close if it's not.
This is Herbie.
Okay, Herbie.
Just real quick, Greg, you mentioned something interesting just now. You said you do a three-finger flick up from the bottom.
Right, in the app switcher.
Have you tried, because I normally do it from like the center of the phone, because the bottom is usually more for like, so I wonder if that would make a difference if you did it from the center of the phone, just because that's where I always close out the apps. But then you also said you tried both methods and that didn't work.
Yeah, usually I just flick one finger flick up,
right,
or down until I hear close and then double tap. But that was not working.
Interesting.
Good luck.
Well, that is good to know.
Okay, thank you. All right, next, who's got a new question?
Sharon.
Jody.
Go, Sharon.
Oh, okay. Sorry, Jody. My battery health, it now says it's on 79%. I have a 12 mini. I guess the question is, do I need to start investigating getting a new battery, or I don't think a new phone yet, but what are people's thoughts?
This is Sri.
Yeah.
Oh, I would say 79%, you definitely need to get a battery replaced. Apple stands is between 80 and 82% is what they define as the battery replacement point. So I would definitely do it. I just replaced my wife's phone, which had 78%, and she was getting messages saying she, you know, the phone couldn't process a task. I would definitely set up an appointment and schedule a battery replacement for it.
All right. Thank you, Sri. Okay. Good luck, Sharon.
Thank you.
All right. Now, Jody, I'm sorry. I think we missed you earlier. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a comment about Soundscape. It will no longer be available in the App Store, I think, after Friday, after the 6th. And then after June, Microsoft won't be supporting it anymore. And it's going to become an open source app. So hopefully somebody else will pick it up and it will still be available. But I just wanted to give people a heads up that if you want to get the Soundscape app, which is really fantastic, that you should do it this week because it won't be available in the App Store.
All right. Thank you, Joni. All right. Who's next? Somebody new? New problem? New question? Who would like to go? Somebody that hasn't had a turn? Love to hear from you.
Oh, this is Herbie with a quick something interesting.
Hang on. Anybody else? Yeah. I'd like to hear from somebody that hasn't spoken yet. Some of our new users, old users, regular users.
I have a question. I mean, I'm
good. Go for it, Tim.
So yes. Anyway, so you were talking about battery percentage. I just went into settings and it went over to battery and it said battery percentage off and then on. And how do you get the battery percentage? I don't even know how to do that.
All right. What a good question. Who would like to?
This is Sri.
Go, Sri.
So I think, Tim, what phone do you have, Tim? I forgot.
He's got a 7.
Seven. I have a 7.
So from a voiceover perspective, it's going to read the battery. The battery health is where you want to go look at. So when you go to settings, battery, and then you go to battery health.
Battery health.
Yeah. Mm. If you double tap on that, that's what brings up the battery health percentage.
Oh. So is that under battery or is that a different thing in settings? Battery health.
It's a setting inside battery.
Oh, it's inside battery. Okay, I'll look for it. Thanks.
Right. And just to clarify, this battery health percentage is different from the percentage that we usually see in our status bar at the top right. So, okay. All right.
This is Sri.
Go, Sri.
I just want to make it clear that battery health percentage is really not a true indication of your actual battery. It's your battery is actually a little bit worse than that percentage that it indicates, just so you know.
This is Brad.
Go, Brad.
Yeah, I think what Tim's talking about is he sees in batteries percentage. This is for sighted people. It will tell sighted people. There's like a little battery thing, and it's got like little bars that indicate how much your battery has percent, you know, power has. But for sighted people, it will actually say a percentage. But for those of us who are voiceover users, whether or not this is turned on, voiceover users will always hear a percentage. So this is kind of irrelevant to us. Whether it's on or off, it doesn't matter.
All right, thanks, Brad. Okay, I thought I heard somebody else. Who else has a new question? Good question, Tim. Good job. That's what we're here for. Anybody else? New question?
Sharon, can I just ask Sri a quick question?
Go ahead. You can ask everybody a question. Go
Sorry.
Ahead.
Yeah. No, but when you said the battery health, you mean if it says 80, 79, it's really worse?
This is Sri.
Go ahead.
If you really do the diagnostic of your battery, if you go to it, you'll find out that the calculation is based on what your battery actually came with, your battery that actually came with your phone versus what's the battery set it as the model. It's a little tricky, but if you read up on it, you'll find out that the true battery health is about 2% less than what it indicates. If you do the formula, you'll figure it out.
Okay.
We at iBUG, we've done some examples of how to figure out your battery health. It's there, but you can also search other places to find it.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Okay, who's next? Anybody with a new question?
This is Tim again. It's not a question, but I want to thank everyone. I looked under battery health, and it looks like I need to get a new battery.
Okay. Well, sorry to hear that, but glad you were able.
Well,
to
I mean, I've had it. I've had this phone for a while, so I mean, and I got it from my niece. So
might be a sign to go ahead and get your new phone, Tim.
There we go.
All right. Thank you, Tim. Good job. All right. We definitely like encouraging some of our people. He's one of our mentees, so we are so proud of Tim. So good job. All right. Who's next? New question.
Marvin from Chicago.
Go ahead, Marvin.
Okay. I seem to be missing.
Okay, Marvin, you kind of break it up. Let's get a little, I don't know. Can you?
Okay. How about now?
Oh, way better. Go ahead.
Okay. Is there a way for me to add the schedule for iBUG to my calendar for every month?
Oh. All right. What a great question. We would love for you to come to every event. Okay. Who's next? Who wants to help Marvin?
This is Brad. This is my specialty.
Go, Brad.
Okay, what you do, Marvin, is, hang on, let me put that over there. You go to your calendar. You create the iBUG event. You tell it, you know, every Monday, whatever time it is in your local time zone. And then when you go to the location, you can go to, you go to wherever you find the iBUG URL. The website, wherever you use what we talked about earlier, using the three-finger quadruple tap and copy the URL, and you put the URL into the location. Then you save that event. And by the way, and then you tell that event it is every Monday evening at, in, you know, in, for those of us in the central time zone, it is 7 p.m. central time. You're in Eastern, it's 8 p.m., whatever. So now you have saved it. So now you will find it, and then you tell it is a repeating event before you save it, repeating event every Monday night, 7 p.m. Central, no end date, and you save it. So it should show up in your calendar on every Monday night at 7 p.m. Central, or whatever your local time zone is. Then you will tap on that event in your calendar. It will open, and then you see it at the top, and if you flick down, it should say join. And you just double tap, and it should just join it. If you have the Zoom app on your iPhone, it will join it, and you should be good to go every week.
Yeah, hold on. I think I just understood Marvin's question, because we put out an email listing of all of our 21 events or whatever, and you want to know if you can just add all of that to your calendar one fell swoop. Is that right, Marvin?
And Marvin, you have to unmute. I had muted you. There was a bit of an echo effect going on.
Okay.
I don't think that's true. I don't think you can do that.
Yeah, I don't think so, but I think that may.
You have to do it one at a time, but you know what? It's the same Zoom event. Same Zoom link for every event.
Right, so. But he'd have to create 21.
Yep, you would have to. That is true. That's kind of what I think.
Yeah, hang on. Yeah, so that's what I think his question was. So Marvin, you are going to have to create, you know, events for each one. All right, great question. Okay. All right, who else? Somebody new. Got a two-minute question. Anybody got a two-minute question?
Well, this is Herbie with a real quick minute story.
Okay, go.
So if you want another reason to get AirTags, I had a friend who got caught up in the Southwest Airlines debacle where, you know, with all the flights being canceled, and their luggage had gotten loaded onto the plane and they did not. And so their luggage got taken away and they were able to report to Southwest Airlines exactly where their luggage was because they had an AirTag on said luggage. So
yeah, I just thought I'd mention that. Yeah, we've talked a lot about AirTags, and it's funny to hear, you know, we've been talking about AirTags for a couple of years now, and now it's like, it's so mainstream. I mean, people on the news are like, how can you avoid, you know, problems? Okay, well, take a carry-on, and if you really must take a bag, put an AirTag on, and it's just so, like, pretty cool. So, becoming very mainstream. All right, thanks, Herbie. Okay.
Yeah, I think this is Brad. I think you and somebody did a
presentation on this at some point, didn't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, at some point, some guy I met, you know, in Austin. Yeah. And
yeah. Yeah, whatever.
Whatever. Bye. Yeah, Brad. Yeah, Brad and I did a very detailed presentation on tracking devices. So, all right, we are grateful for that. Okay. Now, quickly, Maria, thank you so much for helping me facilitate the call today.
Thank you. And thank you to everyone for participating.
Had lots of people talking today, and that's what we try to do. And want to quickly review what we've got. We've got a lot of stuff starting off this year. So tomorrow is all times are central, and all times are everything's on Zoom if I don't say otherwise. So tomorrow's Clubhouse, Mac Buzz. Then Wednesday we're off. Thursday is Trekkie Talk from 8 to 9:30. Friday, iBUG Night at the Virtual Movies. We're going to be watching The Godfather Part 3. So if you don't have time to watch the other movies, you could always try to read the book. Yeah, right. Okay, that'll happen before Friday, right? Right, Maria? They can do that.
Right? That's right. You speed it up to 3 times. It just might happen.
they're all really long books, but okay.
I know.
Okay. So then Saturday is I keep wanting to say iBUG Unplugged. And there we're going to be talking about being your best self. I don't know who comes up with this stuff. Maria, do you know who comes up with this stuff? I have no idea. But anyway, so we are going to find out how to be our best selves in 2023 and be better than what we are now. Okay. Then on Sunday, it's iBUG Cafe, and we're going to be talking about the Apple Watch. We get a lot of questions about the Apple Watch, and so please mark your calendar and come for that from 4 to 6 on Sunday. Then we'll be back again for iBUG Buzz next Monday. All right. And then, so we're going to say goodnight, and then we're going to try something after I end the recording. So goodnight, y'all, and we will be back very soon.
Goodnight, everybody. Happy New Year.